Ibn Sina is maligned by many Muslims. They say he's like Afrakh al-Majus. This is Farkhun min Afrakh al-Majus. I heard this once in a talk. Ibn Sina was a devout Hanafi scholar. Really, he was. He wasn't Ismaili. He was a Hanafi. Now he wrote a book called Ash-Shifa. And Ibn Taymiyyah once said about the Shifa, rahimahullah, he said, Al-Ghazali كان له مرض ومرضه هو الشفاء. Imam al-Ghazali had a sickness, and his sickness was the shifa, which means cure. And he meant by that, in lughas, like a riddle, the shifa of Ibn Sina. He'd read that book and it influenced his mind. Now, one thing I'll say about Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah is a great Hanbali scholar. In fact, he's Shaykh al-Islam of Hanabila. He's not Shaykh al-Islam of Islam, right? I mean, no, there's nobody that has that title. Wallahi, there's nobody. The Prophet ﷺ, that's his domain. He's the one that encompasses all of Islam. When we say Shaykh al-Islam, it's of something. Shaykh al-Islam for hadith, Shaykh al-Islam for usul. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah is called Shaykh al-Islam of the Hanabila, because he's one of their greatest, if not their greatest scholar. Now, something to know about Ibn Taymiyyah and about all of ulama in general. Knowledge is based on time and experience. You cannot, in the beginning of your attempt to seek knowledge, know everything. It's impossible. In fact, one of the conditions, according to Al-Juwayni of knowledge, he said, Dakaun, you have to be intelligent. Hirsun, you have to be covetousness. You have to have like a desire for the knowledge itself. You have to have talqinu ustadin. You have to have a teacher who teaches you, right? And then you have to have fahmun sahih. You have to have a true understanding. And he said, وَطُولُ zaman, and you have to have a long life. Now, al-Dhahabi, if you read some of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah's early fatwas about certain Muslims, he made takfir of them. He said, kafir, you know, this. And that's something that a lot of ulama do in their early period. They get overzealous, hasman they call it, right, trying to really cut off the pretext or something like that, sadd al-dhari'ah, and they might say something that in their later life they regret. Ibn Taymiyyah is quoted by Imam al-Dhahabi as saying, لَا نُكَثِّرُ أَحَدًا مِنْ أَيِّمَةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And he said, this is what Ibn Taymiyyah, I saw him in the end period of his life, he said, I don't make takfir of any of the imams of the Muslims. There are people now that read some of the sections of Ibn Taymiyyah and where he makes some takfir and they say, oh, kafir! Right? He's kafir! First of all, let me just give you and myself a piece of advice. Don't ever call a Muslim kafir. We have no authority. We don't have any authority to do that. That, what's called takfir, is solely for the qadi. The qadi is the one that makes takfir. I mean, it's a true story. The qadi is the one that makes takfir. Now, obviously, if somebody says, I don't believe the Prophet ﷺ was a prophet, that's kafir. Why? Because it's ma'loom min ad-deen bid-darura. Things that are known by necessity about this religion, you know, everybody knows. If somebody says khamr is halal, then khalas, there's no debate. I'm talking about subtle theological points, about things that we are beyond our understanding. So we have to be very careful. Now, some people make takfir of some of the Muslims. They should know that some of the things in some of the books of the Muslims have kufr in them, even from some of the big imams. The traditional position of the ulama is to say, هذا كفر صريح مردود. This is clear kufr and it's rejected. وَإِذَا اعتقده كَاتُبُهُ فَهُوَ كَافِرٌ. And if, this is called jumla shartiya, is a conditional sentence. And if the imam who said it believed it when he died, then he died in a state of kufr. But that's the condition. Why put yourself into trouble? So really, as your knowledge broadens, you begin to see that Islam is a vast universal teaching that encompasses a great deal of peoples, a great deal of diverse opinions, a great deal of understandings and misunderstandings. And the Prophet ﷺ, one time a man said, he said, what do you think? And the man said, Insha'Allah wa shi'ta ya Rasulullah. If Allah wants and you want ya Rasulullah. The Prophet ﷺ didn't say, Mushrik, kafir. He said, Ya akhi, la taj'alni niddan ma'a Allah. Don't make me a partner with Allah. He taught him. He didn't say, you kafir, mulhid. He taught him. And this is what the Muslims are supposed to do. Bu'ithna du'at wa lam nub'ath qudat, like they used to say. We were sent as inviters, not as judges. And the Prophet said about the qada, he said, dhabhun bila sikkin, to judge people is a knife, is being killing yourself without a knife. And this is why the al-qudat thalath, qadiyani fi an-nar wa qadi fi al-jannah. So when you hear that hadith, the judges are three. Two of them are in hell, and one of them is in paradise. Take it, I don't know statistics and probabilities, bad odds. All right, bad odds, really. So, you know, just, we have to be very careful. And the last thing, just to say this about Imam al-Ma'ziri, who was one of the greatest of the Imams, he was, they said in his book, in the Tabaqat, they said, وَكَانَ يُهْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ فِي الطِّبِّ كَمَا يُهْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ فِي الْفَتْوَى. They used to seek him out for medicine like they sought him out for fatwa. And the reason he studied medicine is because he went to one of the people of the book, and he was sick, and he said to him, I'm sick and I need to be treated. And the man said to him, he was in Tunis, he said, you know, you Muslim amaze me. He said that one of the greatest things in my religion would be to kill somebody like you. Because you're the hujjah of Islam. You're a proof of Islam. And you make us look bad. So I could just poison you. And yet you come to me trusting me. He said, I don't understand that. And al-Ma'ziri said he thought deeply about that. And he realized that we have to be independent in our knowledges. And so he went and mastered medicine for that reason. And that's yasud al-thughra. That's seeing the opening that needs to be filled and going and seeking it out. And one of the great thughra of our age is a need for scholars, not just of Islam, but also who know the age they're living in. Because Allah clarifies kufr. Right? لِتَسْتَبِينَ سَبِيلَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. The way of the mujrimeen has to be clear. Part of the Quran is to clarify kufr. Not just to teach Islam and Iman and Ihsan, but to explain to us what kufr is too. So we have to deconstruct them. We need anthropologists that are Occidentalists. Like they have Orientalists, we need Occidentalists to write our notes. And Al-Asma'i is one of the first anthropologists in history. Al-Asma'i went around the Bedouin tribes and he just used to write everything he heard. And one of the Bedouin, when he saw him doing that, he said, Subhanallah, you're just like those Kataba al-Barara. You're like the angels. Everything I say, you write it down. And one little story about al-Asma'i, because I like al-Asma'i. He was once in a Bedouin camp and the woman brought in the tea. And this was permissible according to Imam Malik in the Muwatta for a woman as long as there was adab and things to serve. But she was a fatana, very beautiful woman, and al-Asma'i, who, you know, he was with Harun al-Rashid and he was, you know, he was a good Muslim and everything, but he was also, he was a worldly type of person, rahimahullah. He said she was an incredibly beautiful woman and the husband was very ugly. And he said to her, he said, Subhanallah, how does somebody as beautiful as you end up with somebody as ugly as him? And she said to him, Attaqillah, ya lasma'i, have taqwa of Allah. لعلي أسأت إلى ربي فهو جزائي ولعله أحسن إلى ربي فأنا جزاؤه. Maybe I did something wrong and he's my reward. And maybe he did something right and I'm his reward. So anyway, about al-Ma'ziri, Imam al-Ma'ziri رضي الله عنه, they said من سعة علمه, from the depth of his knowledge, from the degree of his understanding, they said he rarely saw a munkar. He rarely saw a munkar. Because of his vast knowledge, he used to be able to find some excuse for his brothers. When, in other words, when he saw something that most people would say is a munkar, he had some opinion of one of the ulama that it was acceptable. It's a beautiful statement to have as an epitaph for you know, in a book about you, that you looked to the best of people and you sought for what are called makharij. Al-mu'minu yaltamisu udra akhihi walau sab'ina marra. The mu'min, he looks for excuses for his brother even 70 times, right? I have a friend who told me, because he's always asking me to come over, I keep saying yes, yes, and then, you know, I said, Ya akhi, al-tamis udri. And he said, Ana taqriban ala 68. He said, I'm at about 68 right now, so you've got a couple more. You know, there's no years in akhirah, really. In fact, yawm al-akhir is the last day, because that's it. After that, there's no more days. There's ahqab in the Quran. which that verse is actually mushkil in terms of the mufassirin. But just to say about hadith, our hadith probably is one of the greatest intellectual contributions to human society, because it is really the first deep critical analysis of knowledge. The muhaddithun were extraordinary people, and intiqad, which he, the Arif mentioned about muntaqid. Muntaqid is actually a maqam in hadith, you know, so it is a maqam. In fact, criticism comes once you get to a level of knowledge. But the reason you criticize is not to find fault, it's actually to purify and to correct. So there's a difference between somebody who's called mu'ayyib and muntaqid. Because naqd is means wealth, and you know, from a wealth of knowledge, you can make criticism. If you don't have knowledge, then you should just, you know, really withhold your criticisms, because you'll get yourself into danger. So about the hadith, I would say, first of all, there we have many degrees of hadith, but there are basically three dominant criteria. The first one is called mutawatir, which is a hadith, and there's debate on what exactly is a mutawatir, but the basic idea, some say five, some say at least 10 isnad in each generation, but most say enough isnad that it would be impossible for there have been a conspiracy of narrators to have fabricated the hadith. And that hadith is obligatory to believe in. It is a wajib. Now there are some hadiths, Imam Suyuti wrote a book called about the mutawatir, and there's about four or five books. There's only about 200 hadith that are mutawatir. There are not that many. And one of them, interestingly enough, is the hadith, مَنْ كَذَبَ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّ مَقْعَدُهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. The one who tells a lie about my hadith, let him take his place in the fire. And that is mutawatir, which is amazing. That means all the Sahaba heard that hadith. So the Prophet said it a lot of times in many different places, and it was transmitted each generation by so many narrators that it's impossible. If somebody comes along and says, I don't believe that hadith, most of the ulama, in fact, I don't know any in the people of Sunnah wa Jama'ah, because there's a difference with the Shia people about hadith. They have different books of hadith that they look to. But in the people of Sunnah and Jama'ah, there is a consensus that somebody who reject the mutawatir hadith is not a Muslim, that they're outside of the pale of Islam, because it's impossible for there have been to a lie. So that hadith actually has, it's called a dalil al-qat'i. It's a qat'i proof in its wurud. In other words, in usul, you have different types of proofs. You have what's called ranni, ranni al-wurud, and qat'i al-wurud. Ranni al-wurud is when it's called a ahad hadith, and it's either sahih or da'if. And da'if is not used for the ahkam. And so anyway, if it's mutawatir, then we have to absolutely believe it. Now, the second level of that is what's called the sahih hadith. And I will say one of the great tribulations of our age is all these muhaddithin running around. They're all over the place. Really, muhaddithun are everywhere. Ya akhi, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then they bang you over the head with the hadith. First of all, that's called in hadith literature, naql al-wijada. If you say a hadith that you read in a book, that's called naql al-wijada. And naql al-wijada by the salaf, so somebody who wants to be salafi should listen to this. Naql al-wijada by the salaf is unacceptable. You can't even relate a hadith that you read in a book. It is actually considered impermissible by the early ulama to relate a hadith that you read in the book. And especially if you don't know the fa'il min al-maf'ul. If you don't know the subject from the object of the sentence, which most, even modern Arabs, don't, I mean, you ask something like, قَامَ زَيْدٌ وَضَرَبَ عَمْرًا, and you say, اعْرَبْ هَذِي الْجُمْلَةِ يَا أَخِي. Man, that, I had nahu a long time ago, I can't. You know, really, I mean, we have to have humility. The ulama didn't make comments on Quran or hadith until they mastered the Arabic language. That's a prerequisite of Islamic knowledge. Now that doesn't mean we shouldn't read the hadith, because unfortunately we don't have very many muhaddithin left, and the books are there, and some of them have been translated, and I guarantee you, as somebody, my knowledge of Arabic is limited, and I'm not saying that out of some false humility, I'm saying that quite realistically. I mean, if you actually get into the Arabic language, I don't know how they learned it. I don't. How did Sibawi write his book? I don't know how he did that, because it's just this endless, there's always new things to learn. I learned things about Arabic language, and I've been teaching it for 5 years. And I'm just like, where did that come from? You know, it's an unbelievable language. Fiqh al-Lugha is so complicated, sophisticated. You know, and so we have to recognize that. So the Sahih Hadith is a sound hadith. Now, a hadith of Sahih that is not mutawatir, sawabun yahtamal al-khata, it is sound and true, but there's a probability, although it's very narrow if it's Sahih, that there might be a mistake in it, because it's not mutawatir. So the even though the isnad and the metan are sound, meaning the chain of narration and the text itself doesn't contradict the Quran, there's still a slight possibility of a problem in it. If it's al-Bukhari, Muslim, al-Sharṭ al-Bukhari, if it's Muslim, if it's one of the Sihah, then the possibility is really quite marginal, and for that reason, the ulama accept it as a sound legislative source. In other words, we can take a hukum, a judgment from that hadith. So we should be very careful about hearing a hadith like, on the wing of a fly is a disease and on the other wing is a cure. So if a fly comes into your drink, then you should put the whole fly into the drink. And if you studied medicine and say, it's clear that that can't be a sound hadith. That's in Sahih al-Bukhari. And you know, لا تقوم ما ليس لك به علم. Don't follow things you don't know knowledge about, because لا ينطق عن الهوى. The Prophet ما ينطق عن الهوى. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم does not speak from his passion, and that's a sound hadith. So alhamdulillah, I lived in Mauritania, which is fly capital of the world, and I used to dump flies into my tea and yogurt all the time. Alhamdulillah, I never got any problems with it. So and now just. The last, and then another thing about Sahih Hadith. You'll hear somebody say, "Ya akhi, that's a da'if hadith. Da'afuhu al-Albani. That's a weak hadith. Imam Albani or Nasiruddin al-Albani said it's a weak hadith." First of all, let me tell you something. There are many hadiths in al-Hakim that are sahih ala shart al-Hakim, and they're da'if ala shart al-Bukhari. Imam al-Hakim considers it sahih, but al-Bukhari considers it weak. And then there's maratib of weakness. There's not just weak, there's da'ifun hasanun bighayrihi. There's different levels of weakness. Some are weak in their isnad or something, but they're strengthened by another hadith that might be gharib or something like that. So we're dealing, my whole point of this is we're dealing with a complicated science. It's not something you can learn by buying a copy of al-Bukhari translated by Dr. Muhsin al-Khan and suddenly you become a muhaddith. No, because there's mistakes in all of those translations. I have yet to see a translation that doesn't have some mistakes in it. وَالْكَمَالُ لِلَّهِ It doesn't mean that the translators weren't good or didn't know. الْكَمَالُ لِلَّهِ Perfection is Allah's. So, a hadith like that, I will just say, commenting on that hadith, is that there is a sahih hadith that the Prophet said, مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ Most of the ulama say, the condition, because remember, Arabic is elliptical, not everything's mentioned. That hadith will have بين قوسين. مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ صِدْقًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ The one who says La ilaha illallah in truth from his heart enters Jannah. So there's your commentary بين القوسين, right? Like a hadith that says La yu'minu ahadukum hatta yuhibba li akhi ma yuhibbu li nafsihi. That's a sahih hadith in Imam Nawawi's Arba'een. No one believes. That's what it says. La yu'minu. No one believes until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. That's a high maqam in Islam. That's not the maqam of everybody. That's a high maqam. So what does the hadith mean? لا يؤمن بكمال الإيمان أحدكم. None of you believes with a perfected iman. So it doesn't mean that he's not a mu'min. It means that his iman is still growing and he hasn't achieved that level of iman, which is a high level. So hadiths have to be taken into consideration of their translation, interpretation, and understanding and commentary by the rightly guided imams of the hadith.